This looks just like the Brooklyn Bridge, doesn't it? Well, it's not. The Brooklyn Bridge actually looks a lot like this one. This one came first. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. This is the John A. Roebling Bridge. Started construction in 1856 between Cincinnati, Ohio, and Covington, Kentucky. This is how most people see the Roebling Bridge. We're going north across the Ohio River from Covington, Kentucky to Cincinnati, Ohio.
In 1,000 feet, at the roundabout, turn left.
It's functional, but it's really not the best way to see the bridge. For that, we need to take a walk. Before I go up on the bridge, there's something you've got to see. Down here, at the base of the bridge, just downriver on the Kentucky side, are these great murals painted by Robert Dafford showing the history of this spot. Let's take a look. You might be wondering how they're driving a wagon across the Ohio River. Well, it's actually quite shallow here. Or it was until 1929, when dams were built on the river to facilitate barge traffic. During the Civil War, although the bridge towers were partially constructed, there was still no bridge here, so a floating bridge was built to move troops and supplies across the river. This really emphasized the need for a permanent bridge structure at this location. Finally, on December 1st, 1866, the bridge was open to pedestrian traffic. 166,000 people walked across the bridge in the first 2 days. It'd be another month before vehicle traffic was allowed. From the murals, you get a great view of the bridge, but it's time to get up there. Follow the footsteps of those 166,000 people for more than a century and a half. With river walks located on both sides of the river and easy access up onto the bridge, it feels like this bridge was built for pedestrians. As we climb the stairs, we see one of the massive anchors on the south side. These anchors, located on both sides of the bridge, anchor the suspension cables. The cables are attached to 11-ton iron blocks, which are then embedded into the heavy stone and concrete of the anchor structure. Unlike most suspension bridges, which only have 4 anchor points, 2 on each side, this bridge has 8. Along with 4 separate suspension cables. We'll talk more about that later. For now, let's head north. The most obvious part of the bridge here is the heavy steel truss system. You're probably familiar with this system from smaller bridges. This bridge is actually using 3 separate bridge technologies all at once for added redundancy and safety. Steel truss bridge, suspension bridge, and cable stay bridge. Looking up, you can see vertical cables coming down from the suspension cables to the bridge deck, and diagonal cable stay cables from the top of the tower to the top of the truss system. Let's take a look at these towers. As we approached the South Tower on the Kentucky side, these were the first things that had to be built. By damming off the water, workers were able to dig down to lay the foundation, in this case consisting of 13 separate layers of heavy oak timbers, laid layer on top of layer, each layer rotated 90 degrees to the one below it. These were all then bolted together with heavy iron hardware and finally concreted together into place. For the South Tower, this part actually went pretty well. The North Tower was a different story, as the watery mud on the Ohio bank filled in the hole faster than it could be pumped out. Unable to buy a pump that could work fast enough, Roebling actually ended up designing and building his own pumps. Then utilized a local tugboat, Champion Number 1, to power it. With this pump, he was able to pump 40 gallons of water, mud, and clay with each stroke of the pump, and finally was able to get deep enough and solid enough to begin construction on the north side. Once this solid foundation was laid, the stonework could actually begin. The plan called for the bottom 25 feet of the tower to be built of sandstone core surrounded by limestone. The limestone was added to protect the sandstone structure from impact, but also from river erosion. Within 3 months, construction of the South Tower had reached up to the water level before stopping for the winter. Above that bottom 25 feet, the rest of the towers are constructed of sandstone. This sandstone was intentionally left with a rough, uncut look on the exterior at Roebling's instruction, specifically to give it a more massive look. I think you'll agree it worked. With the towers partially constructed, financial problems struck in 1857, resulting in reduced work crews and, at times, complete shutdown to the construction site. The Civil War, though, was a turning point for the bridge. The Union Army constructed a floating pontoon bridge across the Ohio River here, and this showed just how critical such a crossing could be. Seeing just how useful this bridge could be led to increased investment and a full restoration of construction efforts. Unfortunately, extremely high inflation following the Civil War led to cutbacks. While the construction effort was increased, the materials costs had to be cut. The main suspension cables were made smaller and lighter to save money, which also made them considerably weaker. Also, a less strong bridge deck was put in place than was planned. Fortunately, the towers, cable stay elements, and the steel truss structure were all built to full strength. This allowed them to come back in 1896 and make some changes. They added a second suspension cable to each side, matching the first. This added cable, which looks odd once you see it, because you're probably used to seeing only a single cable on each side, sits above the main cable and matches its strength. Anchored at each end in newly added anchor points, the cables cross a bit inelegantly, perhaps, at the very tops of the towers, and are then tied to the original cable at intervals along the main span, creating additional support for the suspension bridge elements. They're completely separate from the original cables on both ends of the bridge, between the anchors and the towers. In addition to adding the second pair of suspension cables, the lighter bridge deck was also replaced in 1896. And that allowed them to bring the vehicle weight limit up to 30 tons, which is still the weight limit today. The bridge is pretty loud. In the 1950s, the old wooden deck, which was covered with asphalt, was replaced with this open steel bridge deck. It's a lot stronger and more durable, but it is loud. We're pretty high up here, which gives a great view. But why are we so high? When this bridge was built, the Ohio River was very shallow. There were no tall ships sailing underneath here. Wouldn't it have made more sense to build more piers and a much shorter bridge? Well, yes, that would have made a lot more sense, but there was a problem. And it's a problem we're familiar with today. Then, very much as now, entrenched business interests got in the way. The lucrative ferry and tugboat business crossing the river knew a bridge would seriously cut into, if not completely destroy, its business. So they blocked every effort to build a bridge. This even extended to, according to Roebling, using excessively high stacks on their boats, specifically to make a bridge impossible. This meant that Roebling had to build the bridge to be 100 feet above the water at the time, so as not to interfere with the boat traffic below. Today, thanks to dams built on the river to allow barge traffic in 1929, the clearance from the top of the now raised water level is still 74 feet, but that's still pretty impressive. As we hit the center of the bridge, it's interesting to note the two different suspension cable elements here. For the vertical cables, which are called suspender cables, the center ones are actually rigid metal rods, similar to those used on earlier chain bridges. And those connect to the steel crossbeams supporting the deck, and also provide the bottom horizontal elements to the steel truss system. When those runs get a little bit longer, though, the rigid structures are replaced with standard flexible cables. I don't know if this is just about cost or if there's a structural reason. If you know, let me know in the comments. Unlike the suspension bridge cables, the cable stay cables don't actually come all the way down to the bridge deck. Those connect to the top of the steel truss system. They're definitely more subtle than the suspension bridge elements, but they still provide considerable added support. One advantage of employing a steel truss system and a suspension system and a cable stay system comes not just from the strength, but also from its maintainability. Since everything has such redundancy, maintenance and repair become quite easy on this structure, generally allowing relatively easy removal and replacement of most of the elements without having to do a massive amount of structural work to provide temporary support. That's probably why this bridge is still here and still in use today. Here on the North Tower, we can get a look at how the steel truss system is connected to the stone towers. These steel beams are pretty big, so the towers had to be cut in to allow them to fit. But they were also cut in a way that allows you to maximize the strength of the connecting points. It takes a while to get across this bridge since it's so long. Center span, at 1,056 feet 5 inches, set a world's record, breaking the previous record of 821 feet at Niagara Falls. That bridge was also built by Roebling. The bridge held the record until 1883, when it was finally broken with the 1,595 foot long span of Roebling's Brooklyn Bridge. Finally, as we walk off the bridge in Cincinnati, we get a close look at the main suspension cables. It's only when you walk across the bridge that you get an idea of just how huge these are. Each one contains 5,180 separate wires imported from England. They're spun in place using a system developed by Roebling, then sealed in wire wraps to protect them. The ends are finally sheathed in a metal sleeve before going into the massive anchors which hold up the bridge.
So this bridge, halted for the Civil War, built not exactly to specs after the Civil War due to massive inflation, and then finally completed, was in fact the model for the Brooklyn Bridge, built by the same guy. And it's still standing today, has a new deck, it's had some minor repairs, but other than that, this is the Industrial Revolution.
Before you go, I do need some help. Easiest thing you can do to help is simply like the video, also subscribe and hit notify. That goes a long ways towards telling YouTube, hey, these videos are worth watching, the channel's good, and it'll show it to more people. More people I have come in, bigger the channel grows. Also, if you can comment or participate over in the discussion tabs, that also goes a long ways towards helping with the video stats. It shows YouTube that people are actually participating and getting involved. I have a Patreon page at patreon.com/industrialrevolution if you want to help out there as well. Anyway, thanks for watching. I look forward to seeing you at the next one.